outside, and we appreciate you making the effort to be here. Couple things you'll notice today. Our sister Juanita Benson is in North Carolina, where it's not quite so cold. And so for the couple congregational hymns we'll be doing today, they'll be accompanied by guitar and violin. And so that's a little different than some weeks. I also want to let you guys know, where did it go? Our BBSer, Marvin is here. Oh, okay. Marvin is here from Germany. And so you'll want to make sure to welcome him to the family of faith. He'll be with us for a year. And so we're very thankful for Marvin being here with us. And we look forward to how the Lord might use him here in this faith community and with our community ministries. When we begin singing, you'll notice that we also have our friend Natasha McKinney is here to help serve with our music ministry. Some of you have met Natasha already, and we're very thankful that God's made it possible for her and her daughters to be here with us. There's other first-time visitors with us today, too, so when it's time to greet one another, please make sure to find people you're not sure who they are and welcome them into the house of the Lord. We're thankful for Tony and Sophina for being here, as well as Kaylee, and there's lots of people to get to know. So it's something that we love here at First Church is we love to love each other. And so when it's time to do that, make sure to take some time to greet those who are here for the first time. If you are one of those people, there's a couple bits of information you should know. One, we do have a handicap accessible bathroom in the side room. We also have bathrooms back the hallway in this direction. And we're pretty loose, so if you need to get up and use the bathroom at some point, just do it. Sorry, no big deal. If there would be a reason for us to need to leave this space quickly, the nearest exits are in the back of the sanctuary on either side, okay? We do like to have flow coming in through one door, so we have a little bit of control as far as that's concerned. So next time you come, please, again, enter through the ramp door. But if we would need to leave, you can leave through either door, okay? We want you to also check in at the welcome table, which I think most of you have done already. But if you have not, during the greeting time, you can make your way over there. Make sure that we have your information and that sort of thing. We do ask that you continue to wear your masks while indoors. And when we do greet one another, we're inviting people to bump elbows as opposed to other familiar sort of greetings, okay? I think those are all of the like initial nuts and bolts sorts of things. If you're able, please stand. We're going to sing our opening hymn, which can be found if you want to follow in your hymnal at 517. And this song is called Open My Eyes That I May See. Please stand and join us.
Thank you.
these bulletins. We want to make sure to get one because there's a lot more in here than what we will discuss this morning. One thing I want to make sure you know is this past Wednesday, we had our first midweek time together. That happens via Zoom at 9 a.m., led by Pastor Lexi. And this will be a time of prayer and meditation and other spiritual disciplines, and just a time for us to be together as a family of faith sometime during the week. And so that will happen every Wednesday at 9, and our Zoom link will go out every week on Tuesday evening, so that you're sure to have it. Will it be the same link each time? Okay, so it is one of those, if you're on Zoom a lot, one of those recurring meetings, so if you just have it saved each week, you don't have to get the email to be able to be a part of that. So that's every Wednesday at 9 a.m. And I already mentioned, we're very happy to welcome Marvin, who will be serving with us for the year. We're so thankful for God's goodness. Once he sort of has his bearings more, maybe in a week we'll have him greet you more properly. But for now, he just literally got into town Friday night, so we want to give him some time to get a feel for being here, and then we'll give him a chance to greet all of you. There's a lot of really awesome things happening in our community this month of February, Black History Month. We know that Black History is American history, so we do want to invite you to just take note of a lot of the different things going on in our community. One thing in particular is a play that's going to be at the Gamut Theater right at the end of the Mulberry Street Bridge, and it's called Echoes of the Eighth, Stories of Harrisburg's Old Eighth Ward. And if you've not heard the story of the Old Eighth Ward, I really want to invite you to look into it. Basically, it was an incredible, thriving, diverse community that was a place of refuge for freed men who were trying to escape the Fugitive Slave Act and all sorts of other amazing things were going on in that community. And then the state decided, you know what, you all have to move because we're going to build a big capital right there. And after that community was moved, they moved them again, because they wanted to build the Social Security building and different things like that. So it's an amazing story. It is part of our city's history. And so I do want to invite you to look into the story itself and possibly even attend the play at the Gamut Theater, which starts this coming weekend and the following weekend, Friday, Saturday, and Sunday. We are having Pack a Pew Sunday today. This every first Sunday of the month, if you want to bring non-perishable food donations, you can bring them to the front pew, either during our offering time or as you're gathering. All of our non-perishable donations go to Fountain Gate Ministries, which is just two blocks away. So those donations do stay here in the community to meet food insecurity needs right here on South Allison Hill. Lots of other stuff going on this afternoon. If you have not heard, I'm sure you have. We're celebrating the ordination of Brother Mark Pickens this afternoon at 3 o'clock. Praise the Lord. And we want to invite you to come and be a part of that. Come and celebrate with Mark. Our praise team will be a part of it. One of our native sons, Brandon Grady, is going to be here participating in that service, as well as several of Mark's family members and just other people that have had a role to play in Mark's ministry. Pastor Polita Dunn will be here this afternoon as well. So we would love to see as many of you come out for that, and there will be a light refreshment reception following that. And again, the celebration service begins at 3 this afternoon. Lots of other stuff going on, so make sure that you check it out in the bulletin here. And this time, let's prepare our hearts and our minds for worship. We do want to celebrate. There's two birthdays this week in our big community. We have those names before you. If you're a card person, be sure to send a birthday card to Jen and to Lyshen. And we're wanting to celebrate with our family these wonderful dates as well. So as the praise team plays these first two familiar choruses, we want to invite you all to come from where you're seated. I've already alluded to it a couple times. Find somebody you don't know, because there's several in the house that you likely don't, and make sure that they know that they're welcome. Make sure that they know that we love them and that we're happy that they're here today. As we praise the Lord, we're going to sing This Is the Day. We'll sing it in Spanish, and we'll also sing All That There Is Gate. So as we sing together, together. We want to invite you to come out from wherever you're seated. Greet each other with bumps and elbows as we welcome each other into the house of the Lord today.
And there are extra instruments over by the welcome table. If you'd like to take a tambourine or a drum,
We would love to have some help touching the lines if you want to grab any instruments over there on the side. God, you know all of that we are bringing into this space. We just ask that you give us the strength to lay those things down so we can spend this time giving you praise, giving you the glory that you so rightfully deserve. So God, again, we are just
thankful for one another, for this community that you continue to knit together, that you continue to mold and shape, to be your arms and your feet here in Allison Hill and Harrisburg, and all the different communities that we are a part of. So again, just prepare our hearts for worship. Prepare us to receive the blessings and the gifts that you want to bestow us today, and give us the courage to share those when we leave this space. We pray all these things in your Son's name. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Hallelujah, church.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. So we've sung this song several times and used a different language, but sometimes we just throw it in there. I thought maybe it would be good to go over the Kinyarwanda dialect that we'll do later in the song. The song just basically repeats these same lines several times. Every praise is to our God, every word of worship in one accord, every praise is to our God. But in Kinyarwanda, okay, it's a lot of like letters, it's hard to kind of, so I thought it'd be good to maybe go over it real quick before we do that, okay? So the every praise part just goes like this. It's Ichubahiro. Can you try that? Ichubahiro. Try it.
Ichubahiro.
Yeah, good. Let's try that one more time. Ichubahiro.
Ichubahiro.
And then Nichi.
Nichi.
Mana.
Mana.
All together, it goes Ichubahiro. Nichi. Mana. Try that.
Ichubahiro. Nichi. Mana.
Okay, and that's most of it. There's a lot of other stuff that happens, but if you get that part, you'll be right with us when we get there, okay? Try one more time. Ichubahiro.
Ichubahiro.
Easy for me to say, sorry. Ichubahiro.
Ichubahiro.
Nichi.
Mana.
And that just says every praise is to our God.
Every praise, every praise, it's to my God. Thank you.
know our God is worthy?
Hallelujah.
How many know our God is able?
Yes.
How many have a mountain in their life and they're just waiting for God to move that mountain out of the way? We pray, Lord, today that you, the God that can move those mountains, will do that for us. You don't promise that there's not going to be storms in our life, but what you do promise is that we won't endure them by ourselves. You've given us one another to be strong when our brother or sister or sibling is weak. And you've given us yourself and your presence and your Holy Spirit to help us to endure. And right where you find us today, Lord, we recognize your awesomeness. We recognize that you're supreme over all of it, Lord. And we do pray that you'll protect us today. We do pray that you'll make a way where we don't see a way today. And that we'll just recognize how wonderful you are, and we'll give you the praise. We thank you for being a good God all by yourself. We bless your name, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen.
Yeah.
Lord, we just trust you to do what you want to do right here and right now. We thank you, Lord, for being a good God. Hallelujah. Amen. Amen. At this time, we can have a seat. We're going to invite Sister Julie Newsom to come. And we're going to bless our sister as she is taking her membership to another congregation. And I'll say a few more words about that. And we'll also invite some deacons to be ready in case you want to come and make some payments on our sister at this time.
All right. Julie, can we move you over to the center? You kind of got here before I got in. Sorry. So a lot of you guys have known Julie for a long time. She's been a part of this faith community. And I will say she continues to be. Julie came to me a couple months ago feeling that she's supposed to make a decision to take her membership elsewhere. And while that makes me sad, I also recognize that just because a piece of paper says you're a member here or a member there doesn't make you less a part of this family. And Julie's been a part of this family for several decades. There was a few years in there where she went to New York and then came back. And now she's going to be becoming a member at the Progress Avenue, the first church of the Seventh-day Adventist on Progress Avenue. And so we want to send her with blessing. And before we do so, I just want to recognize all that God has done through Julie in the many years that she has served the Lord as a part of this faith community. You might know that she's a deacon. You might know some of you receive her service just about every week because she drives our van. She also has begun in the last year or so since the pandemic started. We started delivering boxes of food as part of our food distribution, and Julie's just about every week the van driver for that ministry. She is somebody that a lot of you just call if you need a ride, because she'll say yes. Julie is quick to say yes often, even if she doesn't want to sometimes. She has that servant heart and that servant gifting, and so we're so thankful for her. One nice thing, I don't know if you heard the church I said that she's going to be a part of, you might know something about the Seventh-day Adventist, and that is that they worship on what day?
Saturday.
And so, we still, Julie tells me we still will see her, because her worship will be the day before ours. And so she still lives a block away, she still will be a part of our faith community, a part of our family, even if, like I said, a piece of paper is saying, she's a member somewhere else. And so we wanted to value the decision that she's making. We want to send her with our love and send her with our blessing. And so any deacons that are able-bodied that would like to come and lay hands, and any pastors as well in the house, all the rest of you, if you would just, where you're seated, extend a right hand in blessing as we pray. Let's pray. Lord, we thank you so much for your servant, Julie. We thank you for our sister. She remains a huge part of who this faith community is. We thank you, Lord, for giving her the courage to make a decision she feels that you're asking her to make. Sometimes it's hard to do that. And we're thankful for her faithfulness to your calling. Lord, as we send her with blessing, Lord, we pray that you will order her steps. We pray that you will work out the path for her so that you might continue to use all the many ministry gifts that are present in her. We pray that your Holy Spirit will just dwell in her and will pour out so she'll be serving from the overflow of the indwelling of your Holy Spirit that is within her. We thank you for all the many ways our faith community has been blessed by her presence and for all the ways that we will continue to be as we remain in relationship. We send her with your blessing, Lord, this day. We thank you so much for who she is. We thank you for all you've already done through her. And we thank you in advance for all that you will do. Thank you so much for Julie, Lord. We pray that you'll protect her. We pray that you'll make it clear to her where you want her to go, what you want her to do. Lord, help her to just know that this door is always open and that she remains a huge part of this family, even as she goes forward, even as we send her with this blessing. We just love you. We thank you, Lord, and we thank you for Julie this day. It's in Jesus' name we pray and believe. Amen and amen. All right. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, church. If you're visiting us, it's a little call and response we like to do here. If I say hallelujah, you should say amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Thanks, Iowa. I heard you. Praise the Lord. Now we continue in our worship this morning. As we prepare to bring the Lord a portion of all he's blessed us with, we recognize that all that we have belongs to the Lord already. And we just want to trust God with a portion of all he's blessed us with. The ushers can come and pull the table over. The way we do offer in this congregation is, as you feel led, you come forward and put a little something in this basket up here. If you don't have anything, that's okay. You want to come and just bless the offerings that are there. Extend a hand as you walk by and pray upon these gifts. Let's pray. God, thank you for this opportunity we have to praise you with our giving. We know that this is so much more than a financial offering, Lord. We want to give you our time. We want to give you ourselves. We want you to use all of who we are for your purposes. We want to see your kingdom come. We want to see your will be done. Some of that has to do with our obedience in these moments to give you our time, to give you our talent, to trust you with our financial gifts as well. Lord, we just praise you in these moments. We just thank you, Lord, for being a good God, Lord. We thank you so much, Lord, for being our provider, our Jehovah Jireh. And we just pray that these gifts will be multiplied, just like the fish and the loaves so many years ago. That what is given in our time, what is given in our talent, and in our finances will be used and multiplied so that the kingdom work in this space that is done is just overflowing and overwhelming. Lord, we thank you in advance for this opportunity we have to praise you and to give. We love you and thank you. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. As you feel led, the priest team will be playing the chorus. I'm taking Cassidy out of chords. Feel free to come and give as you feel led.
Take me past the eye.
Lord, take us just as we are. Continue to work on us, Lord. Continue to perfect us, Lord. That when you call, we might be ready to say yes. We might be ready to step into what you want us to do. Thank you, Lord, for your calling on our lives. Lord, do what you want with us. Help us not to be fearful or distracted by the things that are to the side, but help us to keep our eyes focused on you and know that you're in the Spirit. We love you. And thank you. In Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. We'll invite the children to come at this time for a time with the young disciples. And Devin's going to lead that. Jesus loves me, this I know, for the Bible tells me so. Little ones to him belong, they are equal, he is strong. Yes, Jesus loves me. Yes, Jesus loves me. Yes,
so A is for anthem, a banner of song that wraps us in hope. Let us know we belong. B is for beautiful. I'm talking to all of you. Your voice, your height, your hair, and your hue. C is for community, where we live, laugh, and eat. And for church, where we worship, mourn, sing, and meet. D is for diaspora, pulled from our homes where we carried away in ships on the phone to Haiti, Cuba, America, Brazil. E is for explore, to study a place like Matthew Henson, the Arctic, Mae Jameson, space. F is for food, grown and farmed with our hands, worked and tilled and pulled from the land. G is for go, towards cities where we were bound, for the great migration from country to town. H is for Harlem, those big city streets. We walked and we danced to our own jazzy beat. I is for imagine, invent, innovate, for all of the ways we are so creative. J is for Juneteenth. We were finally free, or so we hoped in this moment of glee. K is for kin, our fathers and mothers, our ancestors, elders, our sisters and brothers. L is for love. L is for love. L is always for love. M is for march, for lifting our feet, taking the movement, the cause to the street. N is for newspapers. We started our own to tell our stories and let it be known. We deserve the front page. We deserve to be seen and to also be featured in Slick magazines. O is for organize, for getting together, to sit and boycott and make our lives better. Thank you, Fred Hampton. Thank you, Diane Nash, for for not being afraid of the possible clash with police and people who shouted and teased. Because of you, we can go where we please. P is for power. It's part of our core. Sometimes it is quiet. Sometimes it must roar. Like a panther. Isn't that right, Huey P? Power for people like you and like me. Q is for queens. Behold and bow down. Shield your eyes from the shine of their crown. R is for rise. To reach for the top. Relentlessly striving, refusing to stop. Like ball players, boxers, and gymnasts who fly. Sprinters and skaters who zoom to right on by. Old records, old thinking, a sight to behold. They went for the win and grabbed the gold. S is for scientists who charted the stars, studied the bees, took care of our hearts. For Benjamin Banneker, Patricia Bath, for Katherine Johnson, Luther Mack. T is for Tuskegee, an all-black school, where students learn trades and toil with tools. U is for the United States. This story is tough. The birth of a nation was deadly for us. V is for vote. Do you know what that means? The freedom to pick and choose as you please. W is for writers whose wisdom and words bring to life worlds where our voices are heard. X is for Malcolm, also known as Red, Malcolm Little, El Hodge. By any means necessary, he insisted on change, starting with X. He rewrote his name. Y is for young, gifted, and black, Lady Lorraine, who never looked back. She wrote of big dreams in rooms so small, it's hard to believe they were dreamed in at all. And Z is for Zenith, the highest, the peak. The top of that mountain, King said we would reach. He won't get there with us, but still we march on, rising, rising, like the sun with the dawn. Booker T. Washington. Does anybody want Booker T. Washington? Okay. And then we have Ella Baker. I'm sure. Now you know she's your mind. Okay. All right. Frederick Douglass. Harriet Tubman. You like Harriet Tubman? No. You want it? One of you like her? No. How about Maya Angelou? You want Maya Angelou? All right. Well, I'll keep Harriet Tubman then, okay? All right, guys, let's pray. God, we thank you for all of your children in every color and every shape. We thank you for taking the time to craft them so perfectly. We ask that you continue to uplift and protect our youth in this church, and we believe in their greatness. We thank you for them, and it's in Jesus' name we pray, amen.
Amen.
All right, so the youngest of y'all can go with Miss Renee over here. It's up to what age again? Okay, age 3 to 7 can go with Miss Renee. Everybody else can return to your seats. And this time we'll invite Mary Ann to read our scripture for the morning, found in Isaiah chapter 6.
Isaiah 6:1-8. In the year that King Uzziah died, I saw the Lord, high and exalted, seated on a throne, and the train of his robe filled the temple. Above him went seraphim, each with 6 wings. With 2 wings they covered their faces, with 2 they covered their feet, and with 2 they were flying, and they were calling to one another, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord Almighty. The whole earth is full of his glory." At the sound of their voices, the doorposts and thresholds shook, and the temple was filled with smoke. "Woe to me," I cried, "I am ruined, for I am a man of unclean lips, and I live among a people of unclean lips, and my eyes have seen the King, the Lord Almighty." Then one of the seraphim flew to me with a live coal in his hand, which he had taken with tongs from the altar. With it he touched my mouth and said, "See, this has touched your lips. Your guilt is taken away, and your sin atoned for." Then I heard the voice of the Lord saying, "Whom shall I send, and who will go for us?" And I said, "Here am I, send me."
Amen. This time we'd like to invite Pastor Lexi of Jarvis to bring the word. Praise the Lord, church.
Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord, church.
Praise the Lord.
Amen, church. So happy to be here with y'all today. Church, let us pray. God, our Heavenly Creator, who has called us out to be here, who has gathered us together in this space, open our ears to hear, open our eyes to see, and open our hearts to understand that which your Spirit is guiding us towards. Amen.
Amen.
This week, we are turning to our Old Testament scriptures as we hear about Isaiah's great commission and his vision. I always get excited when an Old Testament story comes up that I have an opportunity to preach on. In my faith formation, there was a time that I really jumped at the teachings of Jesus. I remember being really excited about the New Testament and not so much about the Old Testament. When I first read the book, Irresistible Revolution by Shane Claiborne, I got so excited that Jesus was really saying these things, was really doing things. I remember reading Jesus' Sermon on the Mount with new eyes and just being blown away about what was going on. Right? To be honest, growing up, the stories in the Old Testament left me feeling confused. I never seemed to be able to keep up with all that was going on, and oh my goodness, the names. To this day, I still have problems with all of the names. I mean, I can do Shadrach and Meshach and Abednego, but Zaphnapaneah to Tilgath-Pilneser, those are all too much for me. Yet, during my time as an undergraduate, I took a course on Judaism as part of my Peace and Conflict Studies program. There were many things I learned during that time, but what I remember most is the enthusiasm that my professor had for Old Testament scriptures. The way I had gotten excited about reading the Sermon on the Mount through a new lens was the same kind of excitement that she would bring to class as we wrestled with different texts throughout the Old Testament. One day, as we were leaving for class, I asked her, "Why do you find these stories so exciting?" She told me that even though these scriptures were told thousands of years ago, the conflicts and emotions that these people went through still remain relevant today.
The Old Testament is a collection of all the good, bad, and ugly parts of being a human being. And if you ever find yourself not knowing if God has something to say to you, just look at the people God called in the scriptures. And today, our scripture reading is a story about just that. God calling one of God's people. Throughout the scriptures, there are many different stories that we would consider to be call narratives. These call narratives are stories about people encountering God in some way that completely reorients their lives to be in service of God and to follow God's will for their lives. In Genesis, we learn about Abraham and Sarah. God told Abraham to leave his land and his father's home to go to a place where God would build a great nation for him. In Exodus, we find Moses' famous call narrative, where God appears to him in the burning bush and calls Moses to deliver the Israelites out of Egypt. Even in the New Testament, we have call narratives. In Matthew, we see how Jesus calls his disciples to become fishers of people, and they drop everything to go and follow him. As we hear more and more of these stories, we begin to see a pattern emerging. Each story begins with a regular person who is just going about their lives, minding their own business. Then all of a sudden, they have an encounter with God. Some of them hear the voice of the Lord crying out for them. Others are visited by heavenly creatures. And then there are a few who get to come face to face with Jesus. Yet despite the different people who are being called, and despite the different ways each one is called, there's one common thread that they all share. After their encounter with God, their lives are completely flipped, turned upside down. This is true for our scripture reading today. This morning, we find ourselves in the book of Isaiah. Here in chapter 6, we get to learn about the fantastical vision that Isaiah has that has since become known as his commissioning. In vivid detail and eloquent imagery, we see that Isaiah's call has a sense of mysticism. In verse 2, we are introduced to the seraphims. We get a description of the six wings that they have, two covering their feet, two covering their face, and two that they use to fly with. If you have some time to Google some artist rendition of these creatures, I'll tell you there's quite a diverse range of interpretations. However, as you look at the images and read the passage again, you might ask yourself, what exactly was the purpose of Isaiah's vision, including these creatures? In this particular story, the seraphims acted as intermediaries between Isaiah and God. Again, remember, this is an Old Testament scripture. During this time, the law of the Old Testament made it clear that human beings cannot directly experience the presence of God. If you remember the story of Moses, right? When Moses climbed up Mount Sinai to receive the stone tablets, he had to hide away in the mountains as the glory of God passed by him. He was only able to see the back of God and still, when Moses came down the mountain, because he had spoken with God, his face was bright and radiant, so much that he had to wear a veil. Remembering the story of Moses, a story that other ancient Near East listeners may have heard, helps us to remember that being in the presence of God is a big deal. So that is why Isaiah needed the help of the seraphims as he experienced the presence of God. And in verse 6 and 7, the seraphims do something interesting. They touch a hot coal to the lips of Isaiah to rid him of the guilt he has for the shortcomings of himself. And this is where we start to see even more distinct parts of Isaiah's call. Isaiah is made clean in the presence of God after he repents and cries out in verse 5, "Woe is me! For Isaiah, before God can ask him a question, and before Isaiah can respond, Isaiah has to acknowledge the things that have kept him away from experiencing the presence of God. Some of us might relate to Isaiah in this sense. As human beings, there are things in our life and in our world that are inhibiting us from responding yes to God. This sin that manifests as both interpersonal and corporal prevents us from responding to the life that God has called us to live. When I think of this question of not being able to be in the presence of God, of having to consider the things that inhibit my coming to answer God's call, I'm reminded of my time in seminary. Now, one of the unique features about having attended Princeton Seminary was that near the school, near the main campus of the seminary, there was a piece of land that the seminary owned. And it was designated to be for growing and gardening and farming practices. It was, among seminarians and staff and professors, it's known as the Farminary. And I will admit that I wasn't able to visit the Farminary that much, mostly because I do not have a green thumb and I kill every single plant that I've ever tried to raise. But I did go during my first week in orientation to seminary. And when we got to the Farminary, when we arrived there, the professor who's in charge of the programs, he gathered up a small group of us and walked us over to one of the best features at the Farminary, which happens to be the compost pile. And he asked us to look around to examine the compost pile. And I'll tell you that before I could even look and examine with my eyes, I could definitely smell the compost pile. There is plenty of food scraps, plenty of gross rotting vegetables, tomatoes, and other things that I don't really know what was going on. But as we inspected, as we investigated, our professor told us to look closely. And he said, if you can look beyond these decomposing parts, you can look beyond that what is rotting, you can start to see life coming up. See, with these fresh eyes, and with him reminding us to look closely, we can inspect that there in the midst of the compost pile, there were green leaves sprouting from the ground. We could see the worms inching around, eating all that was forgotten and wasted, but creating new and nourishing soil for new life to be grown. As we saw the compost pile with new eyes, our professor reminded us that God brings about new life, but sometimes in order for us to experience this new life, this new growth, we have to allow other parts of our lives to die. So when I think back to our scripture today, we know that Isaiah was able to respond to God, to say, here I am, Lord, send me. But before Isaiah could respond to God, Isaiah had to repent. He had to be cleansed by the coal that the seraphim touched with his lips. Isaiah had to lay down his shortcomings so that he could respond to God. For some of us here, there are things in our life that might be holding us back from responding yes to God. Things that we could lay down and let die so that God could create new life in us. Some of these things may be distractions that we have allowed to take priority in our lives. Other things that we may need to let go of may be the image of ourselves we have allowed the world to dictate. The manifestation of sin in our world may be holding us back from responding to God, but we know that sin does not have the final say. In the text, God utilizes the seraphims to make clean the lips of Isaiah. And we know that this is important because of what happens next in the scripture. So if you've stayed with me thus far, if you've been able to follow along, we have seen just how unique Isaiah's commission has been. This fantastical vision, the presence of the seraphims, the image of God's robe filling the temple. It's enough to signal the distinctions of this call. Yet, There is one part that really stood out to me as I was preparing the sermon today and meditating over our scripture. In verse 8, God poses a question to Isaiah. Whom shall I send? And who will go for us? Again, let us remember, this is the voice of the Lord. This is God, whose glory was too much for Moses to look upon, whose presence is so overwhelming that the seraphim have to act as intermediaries between Isaiah and God. And yet, this God, whose greatness is evident, asks Isaiah a question. When we think of rulers, kings and queens, and even those who sought to conquer, we don't hear stories about them asking others to do a job. We hear stories about commands and demands. Yet here in Isaiah's commission, we see God asking Isaiah a question. So in this story, we not only see the merciful side of God, who through the seraphim cleanses the mouth of Isaiah, but we also see a God who seeks to empower God's people to do better, and who creates opportunities and invitations for us to respond and participate. We see a God who asks us a question and calls us into his presence. However, it's important to remember that just as God has extended this invitation to Isaiah, God has extended this invitation to all of us. And just like Isaiah, we have the choice to respond. To say no, or to say, here I am, send me. This afternoon, we have the opportunity and the blessing to celebrate the ordination of our brother Mark Pickens. For many of you gathered here today, you have walked with Mark through this process. You know that this time has been a long, 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 long time coming. Yet, we are elated that today we can finally celebrate this accomplishment with him and his loved ones. Now, this moment doesn't just mark the culmination of hard work and careful discernment, but it is also a representation of what it looks like to respond to the question God not only posed to Isaiah, but poses to all of us today. Whom shall I send? Mark's ordination is an example of joyfully and faithfully saying yes to God. Of course, not all of us are being called to ordained ministry. Thank goodness, right? Over the past couple of weeks, we have been discussing spiritual giftings and learning about the many different ways we can participate in Christ's unified body. So the question I have for you today is, what does it look like for you to say yes to God? To say, God, here I am, send me. Now, as I attempt to tie everything together today, I think there are three parts of Isaiah's vision that I pray will help you understand the significance of this text. So the first part of Isaiah's commission story reminds me that we too are in need of repentance. This first part is repentance. For some of us, that looks like laying down the idea that we can do everything on our own. That if we just listen to the ways of the world, if we just strive for things like success and money and power, we will find fulfillment and we will find calling on our lives. Some of us, repentance might look like asking God to draw us back to God's presence and away from distractions of this world. So in your prayers and in your spiritual practices, I encourage you to take time and ask God what it is that is holding you back from saying yes. What is it that you need to let die in that compost pile in order for God to bring new life to you? Right, just as Isaiah's lips needed to be cleansed with the coal from the seraphim, what parts of your life, what parts of our lives need to be cleansed and reoriented towards God? And as we move from the stage of repentance, and we look back to Isaiah's story, there's a second part that I hope we will take away from this, and that is response.
So we've got repentance and we've got response. Now the second, as much of the story centers on God's mercy and also God's desire to be with God's creation, right? The other kind of crucial character is going to be Isaiah himself. And Isaiah, he has the chance, he has two types of responses in this story. The first being what we just talked about, the repentance of his own guilt. But after his repentance, Isaiah responds to God's questions with, "Here I am, send me." Isaiah makes the conscious decision to say yes to God. And we know that Isaiah's response is not just those words, but becomes embodied in his whole being, in his whole life, throughout the rest of his prophetic ministry. Again, the response of Isaiah is not just the words, "Here I am, send me." It's the actions of his life. He continuously allows God to send him. And the final part from this story that I hope you will consider taking away today, we have repentance, we have response, and we have a relational element that is found woven throughout this text. Right? So after Isaiah responds to God, after he eagerly says, "Here I am, send me," Isaiah enters into an even deeper relationship with God. We learn about this because God doesn't just call Isaiah and then leave Isaiah hanging. God calls Isaiah to be a prophet to God's people in Israel and walks with Isaiah through this ministry. Right? There may be parts of us that want to respond yes and amen to God, but we hold back because we know that even when we say yes, right, even when we choose to follow God to a new place, like Abraham and Sarah, or when we pick up and leave everything, just as the disciples did, we are not guaranteed an easy life. We are not promised for the road to be easy. So why then? Why should we follow? Why should we say, "Here I am, send me"? And I can't give you a perfect answer, and I most definitely can't promise you that when you respond to yes, God, things are going to be better and easier. But what I do know, and what I do have faith in, is that when you respond to God with your life, God not only walks with you to where you are being called, but God brings others into your life as well. Choosing God also means choosing God's community. So today, as we meditate on the scripture, let us ask God to show us what parts of our lives need repentance. Let us ask God to help us to respond yes to the call that has been placed on each and every one of us. And let us ask God to guide us as individuals and guide us as a church to see our call as building deeper relationships, not just with God, but also with one another. Let us encourage one another so that we can all say with joy, with faith, that here we are, Lord, send us. Amen.
Praise the Lord, church.
Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Amen. Repent, respond, relationship. I see this one, right? Should be easy enough for us to remember. Our response comes from the hymn, line 395, if you want to follow along, where the words will be before you. If you're able, please stand and sing with us. Hymn number 395, "Here I Am, Lord."
Amen.
Between the service and Mark's service. God bless.